Hurricanes are the worst. Every year, an average of 10 rampage across the Earth's bodies of water. They cause death and destruction, often irreparable loss of personal belongings, and seem to be completely uncontrollable. Or are they? The United States government sure didn't seem to think so. In the 1960s, because of course this started in the 1960s, the top scientists and government brass greenlit a foolproof plan to take control of hurricanes everywhere, saving lives and possibly eventually harnessing their power to rain quick, loud, screaming deaths on their enemies. How would they do this? By flying kamikaze planes straight into the heart of hurricanes, of course. But we'll get more into that later. First, we need to look at the origin story so we can fully appreciate the mission these brave or insane souls embarked on. The mission was Project Stormfury, but it all started in 1947 with a short-lived program called Project Cirrus. A meteorologist by the name of Vincent Schaefer was trying to deal with the issue of airplane icing. There was an incredibly dangerous issue of the water droplets in clouds freezing on the wings of planes, causing them to be coated in a sheet of ice that could bring them down and kill everyone inside. Back then, this was a confusing phenomenon. Why was this water freezing when the temperature wasn't cold enough outside for the event to naturally happen? This led to the discovery that if you introduce something that has been super cooled, like a giant metal tube or airplane, it can change the structure of a cloud and instantly freeze its contents. So in November 1946, Schaefer dumped dry ice from a plane into a cloud over Pittsfield, Massachusetts, and caused it to snow, proving that the weather could in fact be controlled on a small scale. After this successful experiment, the Nobel Prize-winning scientist Irving Langmuir joined Schaefer in developing this discovery further. The thought was, if dumping a small amount of dry ice into a cloud can create snow, what if they dumped a whole lot of dry ice into a hurricane? Hugh Willoughby, an atmospheric scientist at Florida International University in Miami, said, "Right after World War II, science could do anything. No one had thought what would happen if you seeded a hurricane. They didn't know about the cloud structure in a hurricane. It was kind of like, let's do it." Thus, Project Cirrus was born. Schaefer and Langmuir found a seemingly harmless hurricane near the state of Georgia, got a hold of a B-17 bomber, flew straight into its black heart, and dumped 175 pounds of dry ice into it, expecting it to morph into a beautiful snowfall and make them heroes etched into eternity. Instead, that harmless hurricane got angry, totally changed direction, and plowed straight into Savannah, Georgia, causing over $2 million in damage. Thus, Project Cirrus died. Despite the fact that multiple other hurricanes in the past had taken the exact same path, the Georgians not only blamed Project Cirrus, but were also convinced these mad scientists had purposefully harnessed the power of the hurricane to attack their beautiful region. Time magazine wrote, "In Savannah last week, Southern blood bubbled toward the boiling point. A Miami weatherman had hinted that last month's disastrous hurricane might have not been an act of God, but just a low Yankee trick." Over the next two decades, there were some other smaller attempts by the U.S. government to control hurricanes that had almost no effect. But in September 1961, the National Hurricane Research Project, along with the support of the Navy, seeded Hurricane Esther with 8 cylinders of silver iodide, and the wind strength decreased by 10%. This success brought back fresh excitement about the idea of controlling the weather. So in 1962, Project Stormfury was greenlit under President John F. Kennedy. Wait, was that why they killed him? Probably not. But that would sure make for an interesting theory, wouldn't it? This time, they had nearly 20 years of hurricane research under their belts and were determined not to just fly straight into the fury of a hurricane, dump dry ice, and hope it worked. No. This time, they made a list of detailed rules for hurricanes they would play with. Number 1. The hurricane had to be at least one day away from inhabited land. That way, they couldn't get blamed if it caused mass destruction. Number two, it had to be close enough for a seeding aircraft to actually be able to fly to it and back in one shot. Number three, it had to have a well-formed eye wall for them to dump the silver iodide tubes into so they could clearly track the results. The problem, though, was that hurricanes, they do whatever they want. They don't spawn when and how we want them to, so it became incredibly difficult to actually find a hurricane to attempt to seed. For the entire year of 1962, there were no hurricanes that fit the description they were looking for, so they just played around with some friendly, fluffy cumulus clouds. It was a full year later, in August of 1963, that the big beauty, Hurricane Beulah, came along. The scientists sent out their planes locked and loaded with iodide tubes, but since weather patterns, hurricanes included, tend to shift and change, when they arrived at Beulah's eye wall, it wasn't distinct enough. So when they launched the iodide tubes, they didn't know exactly where to drop them. So they didn't hit the right marks. Nothing observable happened that first day. So the next day, they went out again. This time, the eye wall was solid enough to aim at, and the iodide tubes hit their targets accurately. Amazingly, it seemed like the iodide was working at first. The eye wall where they hit collapsed and fell apart. But much like the T-1000 in Terminator, after it was shattered, it rebuilt itself bigger and stronger. The wind speeds did temporarily decrease by 20% though, which the scientists saw as a good but inconclusive sign. There wasn't another hurricane that fit the description for 6 more years. When one finally did pop up, Project Stormfury's equipment had been unused for so long that it wasn't even in shape to use anymore, so they missed the window. After that whole embarrassing debacle, the Project Stormfury higher-ups decided to remain vigilant, and they started attempting to upgrade the equipment. But every hurricane that appeared to fit the description seemed to be sentient, and would either stay just far enough out to see that they couldn't reach them with the seeding equipment, or when the hurricane sensed they were coming, it would suddenly veer toward land, getting too close, so the scientists couldn't risk seeding them without risking being blamed for any damage that they did. It wasn't until finally in 1969 that the sweet and sultry Hurricane Debbie appeared. The scientists sent out 13 planes to seed and observe her on August 18th and the 20th. The first day of seeding, they saw a decrease in wind speed of 31%. And on the next day of seeding, a decrease of 18%. They were so excited about these results that the program was dramatically expanded and they were given 2 $30 million Lockheed P-3 planes for the project. But more years passed, and there weren't any more hurricanes as beautiful as Debbie that ticked just all the boxes. The scientists tried to expand the project into places like Guam, but China felt threatened and said that if they did capture a wild hurricane and Pokeball throw it at the Chinese shores, they would not be happy and would make sure everyone else knew it. Fidel Castro also outright accused the United States of attempting to weaponize hurricanes. I mean, with a name like Project Stormfury, I can't really blame them. If it was about calming storms, they should have called it something like Project Sleepy Storms. So everywhere they tried to go, it just fell apart. When no progress was being made, and everyone was being so picky about the kinds of hurricanes they could test, the Navy got bored and finally pulled out of the project. Then, the final kicker came in 1980 when Hurricane Allen rolled through the Atlantic, Caribbean, and the Gulf of Mexico. The scientists watched it closely and noticed that the eye walls were changing in diameter all by themselves without any seeding happening at all. And then suddenly they realized that the updrafts from the storms would have negated any supercooling attempt they had made over the past decades. In other words, not only had they just wasted dozens of years of their lives and millions of taxpayer dollars, but all of the results they saw were just natural movements the hurricane would have made with or without their dry ice or iodide. So in 1983, Project Stormfury was shut down. Its 100 employees, yes, 100 people were fully dedicated by the government to this. They were fired from the project. On the bright side, they do still stand by the fact that we learned an incredible amount of information we didn't have before on hurricanes before Project Stormfury. So it wasn't a complete waste of time. Now we know for sure that we have no idea what to do with hurricanes and have no power to stop them.